meeting of the Oldham County Board of Education to order. It's May 21st, 2012, and we are at Liberty Elementary School. I want to begin by thanking Liberty administrators and staff who are here for hosting us this afternoon. And our first item of business is to approve the agenda. Any corrections or additions, Superintendent? All right, may I have a motion to approve the agenda? Motion was made by Mr. Woosley and seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. Let's go immediately into our special education update from Ms. Abernathy and staff.
And team.
And team. I'm going to ask you to introduce everybody.
Oh, we definitely will.
Thank you.
We definitely will do that. Over the past couple of years, we've done a major renovation of the special education department in the district. Ms. Lauterbach has been instrumental in helping pull that together. I think at a point when the district realized we need to do something very different for our students with learning difficulties. And what we wanted to take an opportunity to do is update you on some of those changes. One of the things with any federal program, it's very compliance heavy, and it's very easy to get focused on that compliance. One thing we have done is made a dramatic shift and to be very instructionally focused in every aspect of what we do with that program, which is why you see this whole team before you. I'm going to ask a couple of them to come forward in a few minutes to talk to you about some initiatives that we put in place, but I'll go ahead and introduce them and their specific role within the department. Lauren Orr is our high school, middle school consultant. She works with our special ed teachers and administrators at the secondary level. Karen Riggs works with our elementary and preschool staff. Sandy Bell, it would take a really long time to list everything that Sandy does. She is jack of all trades. And there's a couple of different programs that we've had her involved in, spearheading some of our initiatives, some of the changes that we've made that we'll describe. Kendra Smith-Weir works with our low incidence special class settings. Julie Sakella works with our speech therapists across the district. And Carletta Cheek works with our teachers who serve students with significant behavioral challenges.
Excellent. Welcome, everybody.
I have a visual for you of some of the changes that we have made within our department. This gives you an overview of how we have made some of those changes and our shifts in focus. Every yellow box that you see there is purely instructionally focused. At one point, the delineation of responsibilities within the department blended roles, and it was just too easy to lose sight of our focus on instruction. So we have done a careful delineation of responsibilities there. The shaded areas in green are for student support services, and the blue boxes are compliance focused. The thing that we have shifted in our look on compliance is we always look at it with instruction and students first. So while we're still meeting the federal regulations, we're still doing our job in compliance for you, we're also looking at the instruction in those pieces as well. This changes based on student needs. So if we put draft on the bottom, I think Ms. Lauterbach and I agree we're up into the hundreds at this point, but we stopped counting, it's too confusing. A couple of the things that we want to share with you tonight are some of the initiatives that we put in place. And I think we see our role as support. Principals in this district are just fabulous at what they do. They are instructional leaders in their schools. We provide them with the supports and tools that they need to provide services for students with disabilities. I think a couple of examples that I would share with you, we at one point served all of our students with hearing impairments at schools around the district. So staff traveled, and what we saw was that did not give them the intensity of support that they needed, nor did it provide staff in those buildings with support on how to work with students with hearing impairments. We have clustered those students at Buckner Elementary, South Middle, and Oldham High, and what we have seen is a huge shift in culture because of the leadership in those buildings. Buckner Elementary has sign language classes for students who want to learn to talk to their peers with hearing impairments. They've done whole staff training. We support that, but our principals, instructional leaders in the building make that happen on a daily basis.
Tracy, welcome. Melissa, do you have one more?
I do.
Ms. Tracy Harris, we really need to get this covered.
I'm going to ask some of our team to come forward now, and we'll start with Lauren Orr, who's going to describe some of the programs we put in place at the middle high school level.
Excellent.
am incredibly excited to share some of these initiatives with you.
We're glad you're excited.
I am so excited. I am very excited. One of the things we've done, we worked very hard over the last couple of years to rethink how we can provide intensive academic instruction and support for our students with special needs and learning difficulties. Karen and I have worked very closely with our schools, our ECS teachers, our principals, our ARC chairs, in ways to rethink how we are delivering instruction and how can we better meet the needs of students and close that proverbial achievement gap. One of the things, an example I can give you is at one of our middle schools, we have targeted those students with reading disabilities, who have identified reading disabilities, and re-looked at how we are providing services to them and focusing on their reading needs. I'm excited to say, after working with this teacher this past year and several teachers involved in looking at the progress data for these students, it's very good news. We are beginning to see that gap starting to close. Some of the other things that we are doing, particularly at the middle school and high school, where scheduling of classes becomes almost like a very difficult IQ test each year, we are rethinking how we're going about targeting services for students so where they are benefiting from good, solid academic instruction within the general education setting, as well as receiving more targeted academic interventions. More of our schools, our middle schools and high schools, we're going to be starting more initiatives like that this next year. We're moving in baby steps because we want to make sure that what we're doing is going to succeed. And we're very encouraged by that. We also, about 3 years ago, started a intensive academic instruction class at one of our middle schools for students within the district who needed truly focused instructional interventions. These students were not succeeding like we wanted them to. So we, after 3 years, the goal of this program was to provide them with really targeted interventions so that once they made the transition to high school, they were ready to embrace the high school experience and be more successful. This year, we've had our first graduates from middle school who have been in this program for 3 years and are very encouraged about the growing maturity of these students, their growth in skills, and their readiness to embrace academic challenges at the high school. Another thing we've been doing, and this is, okay, I'm going to get really excited now. We've heard a lot as a district about college and career readiness, and your work, that's a district-wide focus, obviously. Within the realm of special education, we have started a few initiatives this past year at the high school level, one of which is an elective provided to our students on IEPs called World of Work. This is a class that focuses our students' instruction on how to, what is their personal responsibility in achieving academic and career goals. They work on things like self-assessment, how do I self-reflect, what are my strengths and weaknesses, honestly, and then how do I realistically set goals for life after high school. Once they do that, then we help them and we teach them those occupational skills as well as college skills to achieve those goals. We do things like we explore occupational possibilities with them. We teach them how to interview, how to approach people, how to write resumes. And with the help of Sandy Bell, my colleague, this truly is a team effort. We have been able to combine the students in all three of our high school classes, as well as the possibility of some of our students from Buckner Alternative, and have actually been able to take them to college campuses. This year they went to U of L. We are planning UK for those of you who are UK fans next year. We are an equal opportunity program. We've also taken our students to some of the technical colleges. They have met with college disability representatives. We've had possible employers come in to talk with them, UPS, military recruiters. We're looking at Ford Motor Company as a possibility coming in next year. We have had representatives from Oldham County Chamber of Commerce come in and talk about possibilities within the community itself. Likewise, we've had a representative from Greater Louisville, Inc. to talk about the 55,000 degrees program, which they have initiated through their organization. We are very excited. The excitement comes, honestly, from those students who come back to us and say things like, you know, I never thought tech school or college was a possibility for me, but now I've heard that it is.
many of our students in this program this year, and we've only been doing this, have this 1 year, have made application to colleges and technical schools and been accepted. The best day was when one student came in with this acceptance letter, and he had to show it to every teacher he had. He was so excited. So I think this is an issue we want to keep tweaking, we want to keep expanding, but it's certainly worthwhile in helping our students understand themselves and what their role and possibilities are within the world after high school. Now, did you have a question?
No, okay, thank you.
We also started our young adult transition program, which Kendra Smith Ware will tell us a little bit more about.
Thank you, Ms. Moore.
Thank you.
Well, I think the common theme amongst the ECS department is that we're all really excited about the things that we're doing. So that's one of the words that you're going to hear a lot, I think. I have the distinct pleasure of talking about the Young Adult Transition Program. And before I start, I work with our students and teachers of those students with more significant cognitive challenges and or autism. So the Young Adult Transition Program is a program that is geared towards our students who are on a Certificate of Attainment Test or a Certificate of Attainment PAT, which means that they do not receive the typical diploma. So they will have the opportunity to do 4 years of high school, and then the young adult program is an optional program that they can choose to participate in. And first, I would like to say thank you to the board for your generous support of that program at the beginning of this school year. The program is based at the Arvin Career Center, and the classroom that you guys have helped to fund is beautiful. It is accessible for our students in wheelchairs. It is a wonderful design. So if you haven't had the opportunity to see it yet, I would encourage you to go over and take a look, because it is very well done. So thank you first and foremost for that. As I said, the Young Adult Transition Program is an optional transition program, and the students that are in it currently have completed at least 4 years of high school and are now working on what their future lives might look like. So prior to going into the young adult program, I sit down with each family and do what's called a futures planning session. Talk to the student, talk to the parents, talk to any family member or a friend of family that they would like to bring in. And we talk about what their 5-year plan, what their 10-year plan might look like. And then the young adult transition program is geared around helping them to meet those goals and to bridge that transition from public school to young adult life. We have 10 students currently. Oldham County High School, North Oldham High School, South Oldham High School all feed in. And it was really fun to be there on the first day this year and kind of see them get to know each other, you know, those different campus cultures kind of come together and meet. And they've really developed some interesting relationships and friendships, so it's quite fun. They are very busy in the community. They're out daily. They do job exploration. They do job skills. They work on community skills. They work on daily living skills every day. And the staff is a very dedicated staff, and it's a wonderful program. So, again, thank you for your support of that, too.
Ms. Kendra, the board will remember we had a Board of Education meeting at the Arvin Center this year.
Oh, good.
And we visited the Young Adult Center, and it is a wonderful facility. We can pat ourselves on the back for putting that program into place, because it is an exciting place to be.
Well, and you know, this was our first year, but I just think the program is going to take off, and we have new ideas that we're developing all the time that I think are just going to continue to better the futures of our students. So as Lauren and Mel have said, it's exciting. It's an exciting time to be in with the ECS department and to be working for our kids the way we are. So
thank you for all you do there.
Thank you. I have another program to share with you. One of my other roles is to work with our students who are served in the special class for autism. And we have had the pleasure of working with individuals from the Kentucky Autism Training Center this year, which is connected with U of L. Crestwood Elementary and Oldham County Preschool were chosen as model sites through OVEC Co-op Region to work with KATC, Kentucky Autism Training Center, this year. So throughout the year, we have had monthly visits or bi-monthly visits, kind of depending on the month, with that staff and myself and several other members from our ECS department to go in and work with both students and with staff, the goal of which is to create technical capacity in working with students with autism. The rates of autism are increasing. The need for highly educated staff to work with students with autism is a very real need, and this was the initiative was to help support that need within the district. Last summer, the staff that participated in the model sites participated in a three-day summer institute, so they dedicated themselves to going to training for 3 days and then carrying that over throughout the year. In addition, KATC provided a training to the entire preschool staff, not just the teachers that they were working with, and they're going to continue working with Crestwood Elementary this year as well. We'll do additional professional development for them. And fortunately, we also have the pleasure of having another 6 hours for the district, so they will continue to work with us throughout this year to provide support for our students with autism. So I'm excited to be on both of these projects for sure. So
yes. Thank you. You're excited.
We're excited.
Obvious.
Yes.
Thank you.
We need pom-poms.
And I would be remiss while the board is, I was jokingly taking credit for that unit, but the superintendent and Ms. Lauterbach were instrumental in the implementation of that unit. And so we need to thank them publicly.
I've always thought one of the hallmarks of a good leader is to develop a strong team of experts around you and let them do what they do best. And that's what this team does every single day. They're just phenomenal. So I just try to stay out of their way and let them do what they do. One of the things I wanted to wrap up with was to tell you where we're headed. I think with Shirley's support, with Mr. Upchurch's support, we've made some great gains over the past several years. But in working with Dr. Wells, we are setting some pretty advantageous goals for the coming years. Next year, our focus is closing the achievement gap. We've set up a three-day PD institute at the beginning of the school year that is solely focused on getting our minds wrapped around what types of instructional opportunities does it take to close that gap with our students. And that will be the theme through every PLC next year. We do monthly meetings with every principal and leadership team at the schools, and that is going to be our focus. We encourage you to ask us questions and hold us accountable on that, because we're working really hard with the schools to make that happen. I do have a little bit of information for you. I try not to overwhelm you with data, because special ed's known for data and paperwork. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. We were very fortunate, and I'm not sure Kevin thought this was fortunate, but he has been working with one of our parents, and so we've been doing a little collaborating, and I have to give him some kudos. He asked great questions, which helped me craft the information that I'm giving you today.
Kevin?
He didn't realize that he was helping us draft the whole thing as we spoke. The first page you have, every year we do a child count, which helps us gather funding from state and federal level. Our student demographic data on the top lists the number of special needs students that we have at each level. As you can see, we had over 1,600 students last December 1 in the district that were being served on an individual education plan. We have special classes, and I've listed those across there so you can see what types of special classes we offer. Those are classrooms for students who need intensive support beyond the school day that just cannot be provided in a general classroom. And then the alternate assessment program, we have 72 students who participate in that program in our district this year. I included personnel data. I won't read all of that to you, but I think that gives you a snapshot of the types of support staff we have working with students in the schools. And then the blue and pink sheets, we do a data analysis annually to tell us the demographics of the students that we're working with in Oldham County. And this gives you a snapshot of the types of student services that are provided. At this point, we have 13.9% of our students identified as students with disabilities. And again, we monitor that yearly. That is down from 14.1% last year. I think that is due in large part to a lot of the work with the interventions and making sure we're providing instructional opportunities that are appropriate for students.
Yeah, I don't know whether I questioned this over the years, whether the rates, for instance, of autism are going up or whether we are just identifying those students in a different manner. But I think also we do such an excellent job with these kids in Oldham County that we attract families with special needs children. And so therefore those numbers will all also rise for that reason.
Mm-hmm. We have quite a few move-ins already for next year. If you all have any questions, feel free to ask them now, but also feel free to call. If you get calls from parents or if you have questions throughout the year, we are more than willing to speak with you about those and work with you in whatever way we can.
Hey, this is, I've gone through this and tried to learn more about it myself. Talked to a bunch of parents about it, and almost all of them are really supportive of your group and speak very highly of them. So you guys are doing a great job.
We know we still have our work cut out there, but we continue to work on that.
It's been obvious, too, to us, I think, that the shift in Oldham County has gone to student achievement, and our resources are being student-driven or based on student needs. So I think that's kudos to you and your department, Melissa, and the support that you get from the central office. Other questions or comments, board members? This is an excellent report. We thank you all for being here and for all that you do for our kids in Oldham County. We are very fortunate to have you. Thank you. Superintendent, anything you'd like to add?
Just like you said, praise Shirley and Melissa and this entire team for their service to children. And they really are continuously improving every aspect of special education. We really do appreciate that. Excellent.
All right. Thank you, everybody. We're going to move along with our agenda. My icons are all wiggling. There. All right. That was an excellent report. Let's move along to the treasurer's report, Mr. Randy Davis.
One thing, as a parent of a special ed child, I want to thank you. She celebrates her 13th anniversary at her job that y'all found for her next week. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that, Mr. Davis.
If you turn back to the treasurer's report, what I'd like to do is just go through the cash balance, the balance sheet, and the monthly income expense statement with you, just for your review, discussion, and then ultimately your approval of such, as you do not have any other questions on it. Basically, on page one of that report, we just reflect the cash balances as of April 30th. You can see our general operating cash is at $29 million. Basically, that's down from last year, it's down about $2.4 million. And a lot of that has to do with the loss of the federal funding from the prior years. So we are starting to affect the cash balances now. As that funding terminated or expired, it was a three-year funding, and the last numbers, the last amounts will be received fiscal June 30, 2012. There's not much. I mean, the other couple pages here just detail that front page, which is a summary of all the accounts. If you would, I would like for you to turn back to page. I believe it's page six, which is just a summary of the cash balances compared to previous years. And that's where I kind of want to show you, just to let you see, if you look at the April balances there, this is the operating cash, the general fund cash. And you see again, if you go back to the prior couple of years, you see it's been decreasing. And the balance that we have now reflects more back to 2009, which was when the federal funds started coming in from the recovery. Again, that's just to give you a little background on that. On page eight is the balance sheet that we have. Again, this is as of April 30th. There's not a great deal of change on that. Basically, the items that change pretty much is just the cash balances, and then our withholdings change based on what's been withheld and what has not been paid in for insurance, taxes, and those type items that are withheld from the employees' wages. And then, of course, the employer's portion also. On page 18 is the where it starts the income statement, income and expense statement for the month, and it gives you a little bit of background when you look at the compared to last year. It looks like we're pretty much in line in terms of our expenses for what we have budgeted. We did hit the contingency this past month for about $250,000. One was for diesel fuel, about $100,000, and then the other was for ESL, I believe, no, ELL program, where the wages had not been budgeted for, and so we appeared that was going to be short, so we've hit that to get that up to where it will be for the end of the year. Overall, I think we'll wind up pretty much where we stayed we would be, somewhere around 7.2 is a contingency number end of the fiscal 2012. If there's any questions on any of those reports in terms of the balance sheet, income, expenses?
Questions, board members, on the treasurer's report?
I know you had the contingency, but do you see when the final budget's done this year, any money left over?
Well, I think there was originally, it was budgeted, the contingency to be about $7.2 million. I think it's going to come in right at, I think where the numbers were budgeted, I think would be. We've had a few changes. The property tax has been a little bit higher than what we thought the collections have been, but we've had these other expenses. So it looks like it's going to come in pretty much to where it was estimated last year when it was budgeted. I'll know a little bit more when we get to the end of May, because we will have an idea about where all the, we have a lot of teacher salaries that go out here in June for the last part of the year. I'm trying to get a handle on exactly what that would be, but it appears, based on my discussion with everyone, to be fairly close to what it is now.
Randy, you want to take a minute and explain the way they're changing the contingency?
Yeah, I will. The contingency calculation is just changed last week in terms of the percentage. Previously, what you did, your contingency that you had was based on all your funds. It was fund 1, 2, 310, 320, 51, all your funds. And that's where it was originally calculated, and it came out about 7%. Now they've changed that calculation, whereas you only take into consideration your Fund 1 and your Fund 51 and the food services. And so when you do that, the percentage of your contingency to your expenses goes up. It doesn't change your what's available, but your percentage would go right now if you calculated the working budget on the previous year. Under the old method, it was 7.2%. Under the new method, it would be 9.3%. So it makes it, from my standpoint, it looks like it inflates the percentage, so it appears that it's more than the previous year. But when you look at it, the only thing that really changed with the calculation is going to be a little bit hard when we're estimating for 2013. But we have and I'll go through that later on in terms of the budget. But when you do that, it appears it raises the percentage of your contingency up, and it does, but it doesn't change the actual dollar amounts that are available.
Food service fund,
what's that?
Food service.
Just a general fund.
General fund.
Yeah, general fund and food service fund. And basically, you just take your total expenditures in those two funds, back out your expenditures for what you estimate your contingency to be, and divide that by that total. And again, it changes the amount of the percentage, and that's just been designated by KDE the last week to change that.
Interesting.
And when we looked at it just a few days ago, it was 5%, figuring the old way.
That was on the tentative budget for 2013, that's right.
Yeah. Right. This new way would be almost 9.
No, I'm sorry, for 2013 it'd be, I've got that right here, check it. I believe it would. It would be right now for the tentative budget for next year. It's calculated under the old methodology of 5.19.
Yeah.
Under the new methodology, it'd be 6.62.
Okay.
So, but again, it's the same dollars. It's just a different manner in which you calculate the percentage. And for the years, previous, you've always looked at this percentage on all the funds. But now it's kind of hard to compare what you say the percentage is going to be for next year compared to the previous, because they changed the methodology of calculating.
Yeah, and we need to know what that dollar amount is, right, when we discuss, right, what's in the contingency. And if you all will recall, in our financial work sessions, we discussed this very thing. Not that the definition had changed, but the fact that, as the superintendent said, our contingency was going to become around 5% and perhaps even drop as low as 4% next year. And so that's really important to remember in our future discussions.
Yeah, currently it's projected at 5.2% for next year, but the way we calculate in our discussions.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Superintendent.
And that is with really no new expenses other than the step, which is probably the most difficult budget we've put together in my 7 years. You know, there's no raise in there for certified or classified. And so we can talk about that some more as we do the report on the contingency working budget. But I just want you all to hear what the contingency is and to understand this. States come in and actually change the formula for that, which, in my opinion, inflates numbers that haven't changed.
Right.
Yeah, and we will have further discussion on that when we receive the working budget report from you, Mr. Davis. Thank you. So at this time, Superintendent, would your recommendation be to approve the treasurer's report, sir? Motion to approve the treasurer's report. Made by Ms. Beckner and seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. All right, bills and claims, Mr. Davis, please.
We have a total of 745 invoices here for approximately about $3,331,000 of items. I think if you've reviewed them, there's really nothing in there that's unusual. There was approximately on the first page there, on page 3, there was approximately 152 iPads that were purchased there.
Right.
That would bring someone a question. But overall, they're pretty much in line. As far as I looked, if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer whatever that you might have. I can't answer tonight. I'll show you two hands. But I think they're pretty much in line in terms of their description, and nothing seemed to be unusual.
Board members, did you have any questions?
There was also a $250,000 contract for
writing.
And the more information you can provide us in this report, the better we can understand it. Mr. Davis, for instance, when I see that figure regarding iPads, it's helpful for us to know that we've purchased 152 for that amount.
They're limited in terms of the description.
I realize that.
I'm trying to go through that and promote the information for you.
Yeah. Questions or comments? Motion to approve bills and claims. I know he recommends that. Made by Mr. Woosley, seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. All right, board members, we have some minutes from the regularly scheduled, thank you, Mr. Davis, regularly scheduled board meeting from April 30th, 2012. Corrections or additions to these minutes? All right, motion to approve, made by Ms. Beckner, seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. Thank you all. Superintendent? I think we are ready for the notice to the Board of Personnel Actions, please.
Yes, I would just ask the board to add these to your minutes and take them under advisement this time.
Questions or comments on that report? Thank you, sir. We now have consent agenda items A through G. Your recommendation, Superintendent?
To approve, please.
Motion to approve the consent agenda items made by Mr. Dodson and seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. At this time, the board needs to go into executive session. And we need to go into executive session to discuss the following matters. The first is litigation concerning a student personnel matter. The second is litigation involving Title IX athletics, and the third is potential litigation regarding a district construction project. The board needs to go into executive session pursuant to KRS 61.810C to meet with the board's attorney regarding preparation and strategy, the public disclosure of which would jeopardize the board's position. The board also needs to discuss a personnel matter under KRS 61.810F that may result in the appointment of individual personnel. So may I have a motion for us to go into executive session, please? Motion made by Ms. Beckner and seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. Thank you all. Okay, then I'm not saying anything this from the heart. It's giving me the whole microphone sign. I'm not even saying anything. All right. The board has just come back from executive session. Is there any action coming out of executive session, board members?
There is. I move that the board approve the contract prepared on May 14th with Dr. Wells for employment as the superintendent of Oldham High School.
Motion has been made to forward the contract with the board and Dr. Wells. Is there a second for that motion? The second is made by Mr. Dodson, and the motion was made by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor, and that's 4-0. Congratulations, Dr. Wells, you got a contract. All right, welcome everybody to Liberty Elementary School, one of our favorite elementary schools. Mrs. Smith, thank you and your staff for hosting us this afternoon. It's your first day out of school and you had to come back and put on a dressed up look and get ready for the board meeting, so thank you. We are going to move right along with the agenda. And the next item of business on the agenda is superintendent report number one, sir.
Yes, ma'am. At this time, I'll ask Mr. DeWalt to give us an update on construction.
Okay, this evening, of course, with summer just beginning, all the construction work is ready to kick off. We've gotten a good jump start at Centerfield Elementary School. The work listed in your agenda includes the foundations for both additions are installed. We've got block walls going up on this two-story addition. Electrical rough-ins have been completed in the classroom areas. And today, movers began emptying out the building. Also, while that's going on, they poured about a 200-foot sidewalk along the front of the building. And plenty of demolition starting to take place. Ductwork came down in the gymnasium, and the ceilings will start coming down probably tomorrow, if not this evening. They're working two shifts, basically, at this time. Wow. Oldham County Middle School, the staff is moving out of classrooms that will be abated for asbestos, and the demolition is set to begin in the next couple of days on that project. Arvin Center Junior Guard and EMT, that job is progressing nicely in that new block walls are installed and even prime painted in the new rooms. HVAC ductwork has been installed already along with the ceiling grid and just waiting for light fixture to come in order to do an above ceiling inspection. And all the existing walls have been patched, so our contractor there is making great strides in pushing that project along. We've had several progress meetings at LaGrange on our boiler and water heater job. The boilers are on site, as is the water heaters. The old boiler tube type has been removed. Asbestos abatement has been completed. Concrete pad for the new boilers has been installed. And electrical work for the new equipment has begun. So it was really paying off for us getting a good jump start and allowing these contractors to get started in areas that they could while school was going on. Our Camden Station grease trap and hardware project, of course, there was no work we could do preliminarily on that except for getting the materials ordered and ready to start. Tonight, of course, y'all approved the South Paving 3 project, so that'll be kicked off very soon. Our Buckner Elementary Library lights and kitchen hood, that equipment and material has been ordered. our miscellaneous site improvements, where we did a lot of concrete sidewalks, ramps at preschool, and some new steps behind South Middle, and some of these other jobs are virtually complete. A few more minor little items to go there. And then the bleacher demolition for South Middle and Old County Middle will begin, I think, tomorrow at one of the schools. So we've got a really good jump start and got a lot of work going on this summer.
Excellent report, Mr. Ewald. You are off to a running start this summer. Any questions, board members?
What do you anticipate the LPC ever meeting?
Well, of course, with a lot of the things that have happened trying to get jump started on this summer, they got pushed back a little bit, and Paul and I discussed the timing of that and agreed that, that we'll focus on that at the start of the school year in the fall. That would really kick that off and get that pushed out.
Can you send something out to the members of the LPC just a little bit?
Certainly.
Other questions, board members? Thank you, Mr. Winslow. Thank you, Mr. Ewald. I would like to ask members of the audience if you could hear us in the back with that airplane engine in the back left corner. Is the sound okay? Because our alternative is going to be to meet in the sauna, and we will have to start taking off layers. Can you hear? Okay, thank you. Superintendent report number two, sir.
Yeah, this next enclosure is a list of school board meeting dates and locations for the 12-13 school year.
I have one note of concern with respect to the calendar. The July board meeting is set tentatively for July 30th. I cannot be there on the 30th, so if the board would entertain a consideration to move that forward to July 23rd, let me know if that would be.
I don't have a problem with the date, but can we change the location? We discussed going over to the annex at the bus compound. We didn't make it there this year. Is it possible to do that in July?
Yes.
Certainly. All right, Ms. Stivers, if you'll amend that schedule to July 23rd at the annex, Mr. Woosley?
Yes.
Yeah.
We're also at South Oldham, August 27th. So we're on the gym.
All right, we need to revisit the location for that August meeting to Ms. Stivers. We could discuss that and get back to Ms. Stivers with a suggestion for that, Mr. Woosley. Other comments, board members? All right, we will approve this schedule at the next board meeting. Thank you, Superintendent. Mrs. Smith, would you like to move forward with the student showcase?
Welcome, and we are going to move forward as quickly as possible to keep the air moving and the agenda moving forward. Our showcase tonight is focused on the Gates program here at Liberty, as well as some things that have been going on in the district with district resources. So Melinda Hadley, who is our media specialist, also wears the hat of our Gates coordinator, and she is going to do the presentation along with a couple of our fifth grade friends.
Welcome, Ms. Hadley.
Thank you. I want to thank the board for providing the resources for our students to not only have remediation experiences, but through funding the Gifted and Talented Educational Services Program, otherwise known as GATES, you've served many students with rigorous enrichment opportunities. Through the leadership of Assistant Superintendent Anita Davis, the county's GATES program has created comprehensive guidelines for identifying gifted learners, as well as defined a variety of service options to best meet student needs. Thank you also for funding the district resource teachers for primary talent pool, elementary GT, and secondary GT. Shannon, Janet, and Jackie are an invaluable resource to all of us. So tonight, we don't want to just highlight Liberty's Gates program, but the district experiences that all elementary Gates students have participated in this year. You're going to see pictures behind you of students playing on our screen. Many of the students took their experiences with Janet Frazier, our elementary district resource teacher, back to their classrooms and shared them with their classmates, so that an enriching experience was provided for all elementary students. The GT students share their knowledge of building structures and provide opportunities for students to collaborate on designing bridge structures as well as creating a geodesic dome. So now I'm going to turn it over to two of the students who have benefited from their involvement in the GATES program, Nathan Eagles and Libby Foster.
Hello, welcome. Nathan, hold that thought a minute, honey. I think we do need to turn the fan off, Ms. Smith. I want to be sure that we hear every word that you say to us, Mr. Nathan. We're ready.
One of the activities we did in our structures architecture unit was building a tower or skyscraper. We are going to give you the opportunity to perform this task. You will be on two teams of three. Your team will have 5 minutes to create a strong skyscraper using marshmallows and spaghetti. Make sure
this is a terrible idea. These are not gifts for them. I'm just teasing.
Make sure that your structure can hold weights. Okay, make sure you have a sturdy base to keep your structure from having to work is when building twists on its axis left, which weakens the structure. And
you need more space.
What kind of weight are you supposed to
put? Just sit there on your pretty face. Dr. Wells, they'd like to invite you to participate.
We need a third. Mr. Dodson. Taught us to always make a sturdy base for your building because a strong foundation and keep your structure standing tall. Just like a good education gives us a strong foundation so that we can be successful in life.
Thank you for participating in this activity. We hope you enjoyed seeing a small glimpse of the learning experiences we have been exposed to this year through GATES.
Thank you, Nathan and Libby. Are you finished? Thank you, Ms. Hadley. It's always a pleasure to participate in these student showcases. Have a great summer. Nathan, are you also moving up to sixth grade? Moving on up. Good job, guys. Are we ready to move on with the agenda? All right, Superintendent, we make a swell team. Recognitions.
Let's we did build a tower on the TV.
At this time, we would like to move forward with our recognition portion of the meeting.
Which is to recognize some really bright and successful students. Most of this program has to do with the Duke University Talent Search. I'll take a moment and explain that. We're going to bring these very talented kids up and show them some recognition. This talent search is now beginning its 32nd year. It's the largest program of its kind in the nation, representing 6,000 junior and middle high schools in the Duke TIP 16 state region. Over 2 million students have completed the talent search since the inception in 1980. Students who participate in the talent identification program at the 7th grade level may qualify for both state and or national recognition based on their SAT and ACT scores. Oldham County had 135 students participate in the talent search this year. This is the largest number we've ever had in the years that we've been doing this. Over 61,000 students participate nationally. Of the 135 Oldham County students, over half receive recognition this year. That is very outstanding. Here are the qualifying levels. For ACT English, you have to score 20. Also for math, 20. Reading and science are both 21. Or you can have three of the four following scores: English 19, math 19, reading 20, and science 20. The SAT criteria in math, 520, critical reading, 510, writing, 500, or two of the three following: math, 510, critical reading, 500, and writing, 490. Students receiving this recognition are invited to the state ceremony, which is held each May at Western Kentucky University. Oldham County had 74 students recognized at the state level for achievement. Last year, we had 46. At this time, I'll begin with East Oldham Middle School. Mr. Griffin Allen. Come on up, Griffin. Margaret Campbell. Mark Gilfeather. Lydia Jackson. Darren Jackson. Marcus Roth. Daniel Shercliffe. Now for North Oldham Middle School, Alexander Betson. Benjamin Carpenter. Carolyn Carter. Sarah Cox. Jacob Culler. Alyssa England. Marina England. Tyler Goldberg. Bryce Brady. August Kingsley. Joseph Klum. Adon Kuhn. Olivia Luzio. Jasmine McCoy. Christopher McDearman. Shelby McWilliams. William Alone. Benjamin O'Brien. Matthew Honey. Michael Schultz. Anna Saray. Gabrielle Smedley. Jackson Stewart. Wilton Stone. Ryan Talbot. Benjamin Tucker. Thomas Wheeler. From Oldham County Middle School, Claire Babby. William Balmer. Jordan Burhoe. Connor Ferris. Brandon Howard. Leah Hulsman. Adrian Jones. Rosemary Kent. Eric Kirby. Sierra Lindman. Nancy Logaitis. Octavio Menendez. Matthew Noel. Logan Parker. John Turner. Emily Urban. Maria Williams. Brooke Zarotny. South Oldham Middle School, Lucas Arvin. David Byerly. Dylan Bazertney. Seth Chappelle. Ryan Davis. Shelby Farrell. Aaron Gunther. Wyatt Huttenlocker. Tony Liu. Jacob Sokobe. Isabel Von Busch. Overlooked anyone at this point for these recognitions? Lydia Jackson, are you here? Let's show a special applause for all these brilliant students. We have a few more to go.
We have six students that have certainly made it to the grand recognition ceremony. Two of them cannot be here tonight. I'll call all the names in just a minute. To receive recognition at this level, your English and math ACT score has to be at 28. It's pretty good for middle school. It's pretty good for anybody. Your reading has to be 30. Your science and composite score has to be 26. The SAT and math has to be 670. Critical reading, 650. Critical writing, 650. The SAT math plus the SAT critical reading has to be a total of 1850 on the SAT. That's pretty amazing. Seventh grade talent search participants with the highest scores on the ACT and SAT are honored at the grand recognition ceremony held in Cameron Indoor Stadium on the Duke University campus. Only top 3% of participants receive this honor. Oldham County had six nationally recognized at this level. We had six last year as well. He's not here tonight, I don't believe, but from East Oldham Middle School, Alexander Banaskazak. That's a big shout out to him. From North Oldham Middle School, I don't think he's here either, Jack Delegale. From North Oldham Middle, William Olone. Stay up here if you don't mind. Matthew Oney. From Oldham County Middle School, Robert Hillerick. And from South Oldham Middle, David Byerly. Special thanks are in order to the middle school Gates coordinators who assist students in this entire process. Joe Percival at Oldham County Middle School, Cheryl Atkinson at South Oldham Middle, Tracy Scholl at North Oldham Middle, and Sarah Collier at East Oldham Middle. Are any of you here this evening? Any of the Gates coordinators? Don't blame me, that's okay. That's all right. Congratulations to these two young men. I show them. And finally, the Gatton Academy of Math and Science in Kentucky, down on the campus of Western Kentucky University, receives application from students all across the state. We have two students who have applied and been accepted to that. I think one of them is here tonight. Ajit Deshpande. Is Ajit here this evening? He is not here. The other one is Samantha Dinga. So these two students will be doing their high school two final years down at Western. It's two final years, Ms. Davis, is that right? Their junior and senior year down on Western's campus. So let's show a little round of applause for them. We have a little round of applause. Thank you all.
Thank you, Superintendent. Mr. Woosley, this is one of the highlights of our school year, when we are able to recognize all of these outstanding students. So congratulations to you and your families. I always invite visitors to stay for the rest of our board meeting, but it's not mandatory. So if you would like to take this opportunity to leave us, we appreciate you being here and have a wonderful summer. Public expression, but it doesn't appear that anybody wants to speak with the board, so we're going to move right along. We have two action items. Action item H, Superintendent.
Mr. Davis has done a nice job preparing the 10th working budget for 12-13. This is the second phase of our budgeting process, as you all know, and we prepare that, and it can be adjusted in September, but however we all know that is difficult to do once you've committed funds at this point. So I would ask Mr. Davis to come and just do an overview of that, please.
Thank you. Welcome back, Mr. Davis.
Thank you very much. As Superintendent Upchurch noted, that this is a tentative budget here, and it's based on the information available as to date. It's due into the state by May 30th, and then the final working budget is due in to the state, I believe, May September 25th, so at that point.
And these items are subject to change, one, you know, in terms, once we find out the property assessment, you know, that's finalized in July. We have a estimate right now from the PVA. The SEEK is fairly, as far as I know, is set. That's what the state is in that work.
I don't think the audience can hear. Could just start all over, Mr. Davis. Not really.
Thank you. As I say, an intended budget, and we'll go through the numbers now. But basically what I want to, you know, we have worked on this for the last month or so to come up with some, what we believe to be fairly good numbers. Again, they're subject to change. Right now, the budget has been based on the SEEP funding. It's basically, it's $38.33 per student. And once the, there's various adjustments that the state makes. And when you look at it compared to last year, the per budget, or the amount per student is actually, after you back out our, the district portion, is $34.69 a student. Last year was $34.84 a student. So it's $15 per student reduction in the net numbers that we're getting. We believe, based on the estimates that they've given us, approximately our enrollment will be up about 68 based on the numbers that they've given us. So we think the overall net seat will be approximately $53,000 more than we received this past year. The budget does not include, what it does, it doesn't include any new programs. Basically, it includes the step increase, which is approximately, with fringes, about $985,000. It includes increase in fringes. The CERS for classified is going up basically almost 0.6%. And the KTRS medical that the district has to match is going up 0.5%. And when you take those numbers over the amount of the salaries, you're talking somewhere in the range of $300,000 at that point for those increases. So what we have presented here, the teacher ratio is to be maintained at 22-1. We've maintained all the prior programs. There just hasn't been any new programs involved. This includes the reduction of the recovery money, the final recovery money of $1.8 million that's being moved over to, that will be funded by the general fund to keep the teacher level at 22.1. Those are the highlights. I don't know if what type of questions you would like to have. It leaves a contingency based on our projection of $5.4 million, which is based on the old calculation. If you compare it, it would be 5.19%. And that would be compared to 7.2% of what we had at the beginning of this prior year. So the contingency is dropping approximately $1.8 million in terms of total dollars from as of the end of 2013 versus where we believe it will be at the end of 2020. Again, these are projections. There will be changes come along, and I'll be glad to meet with you and discuss these. And again, it's tentative, subject to change, and I guess open to any questions, but wanted to just present this to you for your review, and I'll answer whatever questions I have.
Yes, I got one question. The reading recovery program, is that taken out in the general fund in this, or is it coming from Reading Academy?
Reading Academy is actually being, it's estimated to be taken from the facilities to ask for capital funds.
Yeah, that was what I was wondering, was it out here?
Yeah, it's out there, $202,000.
Thank you, Mr. Dodson. Mr. Davis, this tentative budget mirrors the previous tentative budget by how close the former budget, tentative budget that we have examined pretty closely.
Basically, the only, the one that we have met with, the only thing that really has changed there is
We have the Reading Academy in there. I made a small adjustment on the property taxes, nothing much. It's pretty much where we were. I believe the contingency is right at 5.4. I think at that time we were talking 5.2, 5.3, I believe. So it's fairly close to exactly what we were talking about.
And as we said earlier, the amount in the contingency fund remains the same. The definition has changed.
Right.
Questions, board members? These are not exactly the highlights. These are the lowlights of the tentative budget.
It's a tight budget.
Yeah. Thank you. Superintendent, do you have anything you'd like to add at this point?
Just a couple of comments. Randy and I worked a lot of this. This is the first time, I think, in a long time, that we've not raised and have certified and classified. And you may want to talk a little bit about that, but what we see in there, nobody wants that to happen anymore than all of us, including board members. It's difficult to add expenses when you don't have a revenue. With a 5% contingency, it's dropped over 2% this year. Unless when we close the year out on June 30, unless private money comes down from the budget into the ending balance, it's going to be difficult not only to add more expenses but to sustain them, because what we see, this is a biennial budget. What we see coming even next year, we're cutting seat even more. We don't see any new revenue coming in the district, maybe a little bit through some student growth. We're growing 6 to 7 students projected for 12-13, for 13-14. Unless the district starts to grow again, or unless some way we can get revenue coming in, it's, I believe, going to be hard to sustain the expenses there, let alone add anything else. And so, I don't know how much you've paid attention to across the state, but I would say more than half, maybe 75% of districts, because of these cuts to seat, are not able to give raises to classified and certified. I think the state has put school districts in a very, very difficult place. And in the past, we've counted on those revenues coming in from seat.
Right.
And they're not only not coming in, they've been cut. And so we have to be very careful. If there's any way to add those expenses, I would certainly promote doing so, but it's a dangerous thing to start adding expenses when you don't have revenue to pay for. And that's where we are right now. Do you want to add anything?
Just that, like I said, our revenues basically are pretty much the same as they have been, and we've had increased expenses for the STEP. We've got funds going out for the edu jobs that we didn't, you know, it keeps the ratio at 22-1. So there's not any in the next year or so. I don't think there's that much in terms of what I've read through the state. Their revenues have started to increase some, not enough to make a difference. I don't feel that there's going to be any large amount of revenues available. I believe the revenue is going to be flat next year. And then, of course, if you add expenses, you really can't add, as far as I see, unless your revenues are going up, it's hard to add those expenses, because then you're dipping into your contingency, which is there in case of emergency.
Mr. Davis, I have one question. I know if we was to give a raise, it'd be reoccurring based on percentage. We've got that facilities money there. Is there any way that we could possibly use that to give maybe a one-time bonus that doesn't go towards the percentage raise, that will say, hey, you know, thank you for your work, because, you know, teachers need it just as much as anybody else. And that way it wouldn't be reoccurring. So next year, it wouldn't affect the percentage raise next year.
As to whether you could give a bonus, basically, I'm not familiar enough with the law to determine that. There is in the state budget, there is wording that states that you can request funds from facilities for use. Of course, it has to be approved But again, that's, you know, that's non-reoccurring money. It's a request, a one-time request. And if it doesn't go into the step, you know, again, I'm not for sure that we'd have to be a question legally. We'd have to look at to see as to whether you can actually do that in terms of where it wouldn't hit the salary schedule. It sounds like what you're saying. I mean, it would go into salaries, but it wouldn't be part of the continuing salary.
It wouldn't be part of the salary. It would just be a one-time incentive award or a one-time thank you award or what have you that would compensate the teachers a little bit for something. And it wouldn't be compounded next year if we could get a raise. And it would be something, because the way it is now, if we get a raise, it would be reoccurring next year. We couldn't afford it, but maybe we can do something like this.
I'm sure that's a discussion that we can have.
All right, thank you, Mr. Davis. There is not the mechanism to award bonuses per se. There may be other mechanisms that we can look at with our general counsel. I know what Mr. Dodson is saying. The board has been committed for many years to elevate staff salaries in this district and to try to make them competitive with our surrounding school districts. And we remain committed to that objective. And so I think as we move forward and we approve this tentative budget, we will continue to examine every possible way to be able to do that, because I know the board members are committed to making that happen. It's a matter of revenue, as the superintendent said. So, any other questions or comments, board members?
I'd just like to say, as bleak as it does look, there is two positives. We are able to fully fund the step increase, and we're able to maintain the 22-to-1 ratio, which I think is very important.
Thank you, Mr. Wesley. Thank you, Mr. Davis. Superintendent, what would your recommendation be?
To approve the tentative report, the budget report.
All right. May I have a motion to approve this action item, please? Motion made by Mr. Woosley and seconded by Ms. Beckner. All those in favor? 3. And those opposed? 1. All right. Thank you, board members. We have action item I, Superintendent.
Yeah, that enclosure includes the salary schedules for both certified and classified for the 12-13 school year. We've asked you to take a look at those and ask any questions that Mr. Davis is also preparing for those rules.
Board members, do you have questions over this salary schedule? You have to use your microphone, Mr.
No, it's basically the same schedule we used last year.
Right, it's the same schedules, it's just that it'll be used, you know, as you move up in your years of service, you'll get a different line item, but the salary schedules are exactly the same as they were last year.
The only reason I ask why that hasn't changed is I know at some point we need to revisit this, because I think Dr. Arbor put this in, is that true? It's been many, many years ago.
These schedules have been in place for many years, you're correct.
And we've talked about looking at revisiting this. So at some point in the next several years, I think these things need to be revisited. Make sure we do remain competitive with this one.
Right.
Thank you, Mr. Woosley. Superintendent, what's your recommendation on this item?
To approve, please.
Motion to approve action item I, please. Motion made by Ms. Beckner, seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor? 3. 1 opposed. Thank you, sir. All right. We have two information items in the back of our agenda. The first is an update from the Head Start program. Please review that, board members. And the second is the monthly district energy usage report. At this time, what's your recommendation, Superintendent?
That we adjourn.
Motion to adjourn, please. Made by Mr. Dodson, seconded by Ms. Beckner. All those in favor? And that's 4-0. We're adjourned. Thank you all, and have a wonderful start to your summer.